I have to show you this. This is really cool. One of the problems I have with AI tools when they're embedded inside of IDEs is that they still only seem to be able to operate on a single class at a time. They can work with a single segment of your code or a class by itself, but I'd like it to be able to look at the entire code base and make assessments and changes based on that. Enter this new capability called Claude Code. I'd never seen this before. I think it's been out for less than a week. And as it says here, this is an agent. This is Learn About Claude Code, an agentic coding tool made by Anthropic, currently in beta as a research preview. It's an npm application. As you can see here, you do an npm install dash g with this little signature here, and it will install this automatically. Now, I want to show you a couple things before I dive in and use it. First of all, if I scroll down, it tells me my system requirements. Now, I'm on a Mac, one of the latest versions. The software that it requires is Node, of course. It uses Git and GitHub or GitLab if you work with that external code base. And it requires a tool called ripgrep. I did a brew install and it turned out I already had ripgrep as a transitive dependency on something else. So I didn't have a problem with any of that. So I did the install and I ran it. And then it says, okay, all you do is run the install here, change directory in a shell down to your project directory, and start up Claude at the command line, and you're ready to go. You'll need active billing at console.anthropic.com. Now, I've been coding to Claude for, I don't know, a year and a half now. And if you've ever looked at my YouTube channel, you know I have several videos about that process. So again, that's not a problem for me. Now, there is going to be a cost here because it's transmitting code to Claude and back again over and over again. Now, let me show you what I'm going to run it on. I have a book. One of the most recent books I've written is called Mockito Made Clear. This is from the Pragmatic Bookshelf. And it's about Java testing with mocks, stubs, and spies. And this is the web page for it at the Pragmatic Bookshelf. I have a GitHub repository for the source code of that book. That's right here. So it's under my account, under Cousin for my last name, Kousen. And the repository is Mockito Book. Welcome to Tales from the Jar Side. On Tales from the Jar Side, I try to give you expert advice on Java, Spring, Gradle, AI, and related topics and languages. Now, one thing I'll show you before I dive in is that this is using Gradle. I'm using a build.gradle file. And if you take a look at the file, let me magnify that a little bit. I'm also using what's called Gradle version catalogs. All of the dependent version numbers are in this file called libs.versions.toml. And this is inside my Gradle folder. I'm using the Java plugin. I did add the Jacoco plugin to get some code coverage on this. And these are plugins that are used to update my versions of my dependencies on a regular basis. I say here that we are using Java 17, and by using Gradle's toolchain support, I don't have to change a Java home variable or anything like that. Gradle will automatically detect Java 17 distribution if it's in one of the normal places and then run it for me. I have JUnit in here. I have Mockito, of course. I'm using assert J. I've got a Spring testing library for a section there, a little bit about retrofit so I can do some RESTful web services. Okay, HTTP, JSON, JSON, and that's it. That's basically it. I do have the ability to run my tests in parallel. It's one of the nice features of Gradle. So that is the complete build file. Nothing terribly unusual about it. And now in the next section, I'm going to go and run Claude on this. What I have here is a regular shell. I'm running what they call Oh My Z Shell, OH underscore MY underscore ZSH. This is a really cool shell that uses ZSH, Z shell, that has a lot of history in it and tab completion and a lot of nice features with plugins that I use on a regular basis. I've managed to use it to customize my prompt so it shows which directory I'm in and that I am using Git and I'm on the main branch at the moment and it is up to date. It also shows the machine I'm on, which, ha ha ha, it's HAL 9000, of course. Any rate, let's move on. What you do after you do the install and accept various permissions is you simply type the word Claude once you are in that directory. Now, it gives you the little warning that this is in a research preview. It also asks for you to authenticate with the Claude system. I've already done all that. And it also asks whether I want light fonts or dark fonts, or do I want to take into account color blindness issues? And I didn't worry about any of that. I'm just using the light fonts here. And what you do is you interact with it as though you were talking to Claude directly, but from the command line. And here's the best part. It knows your entire code base. Now it's going to transmit that code to Claude and back. So the tokens are going to add up, and we'll take a look at the costs when we get through this a little bit more. So it says, try edit person service.java 2. No, I'm simply going to say, what is the purpose of this code base? Looking at the README file, it says, this is a code base with examples for the book Makito Made Clear, published by Pragmatic Programmers. It demonstrates various Makito testing techniques as shown in the directory structure with multiple classes. Very good. What do you think of the code coverage? Now, the question is it actually going to run Jacoco in order to do that? And yeah, see, it says, oh, okay, I want to run Gradle test, Jacoco test report, and then pipe that through Gradle tasks and pipe that through grep coverage. Is it okay to run that? And I'm simply going to say yes. Now, I got some warnings. I think those warnings are because on my command line, I'm running Java 21, and there's a little flag I should set to get rid of that warning. But it has nothing to do with my code base. So what it says now is, oh, I need to run the ls command to see if the code coverage test report was generated. And we have options like yes or yes and don't ask again for ls commands in this particular project, or no and tell Claude what to do differently. I'm going to say yes and don't ask again. Now, I do those don't ask agains already a few times. The claim here is the code coverage is very good, showing 84% instruction coverage overall. This demonstrates Makito usage across multiple packages, and there are a bunch of the packages that are in there. The project shows various mocking techniques with comprehensive test cases. Very good. Okay. How would you recommend I improve code coverage? Here are the specific recommendations. For the pub sub package, create a test for send parallel method without using order verification. Enable the disabled test after modifying it to not rely on order. For the HR package, add test for the person class that covers all branch conditions in the equals method. Improve the coverage of in-memory person repository by adding tests for the missing methods. For the Wikipedia package, add tests for wiki page methods that are currently uncovered, especially getters and setters. I don't usually bother with tests for getters and setters. Add tests for the missing methods in wiki response and wiki util. Please add the suggested tests for the HR package. Now, what it does is it shows me the code that it now wants to add. So here is person test. And it created some persons here based on code examples that I'd used. It also is paying attention to the style of testing that I'd already used in the code base. And it's using the same mechanisms there. Test equals with the same reference, equals with null, equals with a different class, equals with equal objects, equals with different objects, null fields, hash code, getters, toString. It's a little excessive. I don't really need to test all those different things, but it couldn't hurt. So I'll say, yeah, go ahead and don't ask again this session about modifying person tests. Go ahead and do it if you need to. I think those tests have a very high likelihood of succeeding. It's just a record. It's not like I'm doing anything fancy in it. Okay, now it wants to run Gradle W test Jacoco test report, and I'll say yes and don't ask again for Gradle W commands in this repository. Now I got an error this time. And now it's trying to update the test. So we have a disable command, API connection timeout disabled to allow tests to pass. And here's the updated set of tests. It's not asking me for permission this time. It's just go ahead and try to run the test report and see if those work. Now, just as a comment, you don't have to have your $20 a month subscription or anything like that for Anthropic here. What you need is the API key. You have to be able to authenticate through the API, and that's done on a request-by-request basis, not the authentication, the charging there, which is really not bad at all. It's fractions of a penny. the cost there tends to be comparable to all the other APIs as well. OpenAI, DeepSeek, et cetera. DeepSeek's a bit cheaper than the others. Interesting how it's iterating on the test to try to update the test to better satisfy what issues they're getting in the response. The costs are fractions of a penny for 1,000 tokens, but they do add up eventually. Here we go. The code coverage has been significantly improved. Overall coverage has increased from 84% to 93%. The pub sub package increased, Wikipedia package, HR package, yes. We've successfully addressed all the areas identified for improvement, added tests for the send parallel method. Oh, I didn't even tell it to do that. That's a little scary, but okay. Added comprehensive tests for the person class, right? Added tests in in-memory person repository, and added tests for all the wiki-related ones. Very good. Now I wanted to commit all this to the GitHub repository. So commit all these changes to the GitHub repo. Now, one of the commits failed. By the way, I gave it permission to do all the git commands automatically earlier today. One of the reasons it failed is I have this experimental project as a GitHub action that generates a diagram for my repository that shows all the code in it. And it's okay, but what happens is every time I push to the repository, this diagram is regenerated. So if I don't do a git pull, then it claims that my system is out of date and therefore it wants to do a git pull and then a git push. And then I just do that and we're all set. So it had to go through that as well. There's the git pull with the rebase and then there's the push again. And now it's telling me all the changes that were made and we're all set. Now let's find out what this cost me. Now, when I put in a forward slash, you see there are a whole series of commands I could run. There's a clear command, compact, clear the conversational history, but keep a summary. Here's the cost. That's the one I want to run. Doctor is if something's going wrong and you try to help diagnose it. Exit, always good to know how to get out of the REPL. Help, of course, init, which will create claude.md file with a code-based documentation. PR comments, get comments from a GitHub pull request. You could file a bug about Claude Code. You can review a pull request. Now, this one I did when I first started up, the terminal setup, install, shift, enter, key bindings for new lines. What I did is when I ran terminal setup, it detected that I was on an iTerm 2 with ZSH and adjusted the key bindings as a result. Could list the approved tools or log out or log in. Now I just want to do the cost command. And it says that this session cost me $1.19. That's relatively high. It's extremely high for programmatic access to Claude. I don't do much with that often, but we transmitted a lot of code back and forth and it handled all of that. It took me just under 4 minutes of the API and it took about 12 minutes on the clock. I'm cutting that out, the dead time from this recording, but it was in there. For $1.20 to improve the code coverage that much, yeah, I think that was worth it. I'm not really concerned about it. That's, of course, how you get sucked in, but it worked, and I hope you enjoyed it. Now, I'll go take a look at the actual repository and give some closing thoughts in a moment. Let's take a look at the repository and see what it actually did. So again, this is the Makito book repository, and if I go here to the commits link inside there, you'll see there is what we just did. And then right after that, that repository visualizer plugin I was telling you about updated the diagram, meaning I should do a git pull now to make sure I have the latest one on my disk, but whatever. If I take a look at this one, this is the one where the commit occurred. This is the comment that it added tests for and comprehensive tests for this one and add tests for all of those others. And then you could see the various code changes all the way through. That's a completely new test here for that in-memory one. And there's the person tests and sending parallel and all that stuff. Yeah, it looks like took care of everything and all the tests passed. I think we're good. Here's that figure that I was telling you about that got generated automatically. You see how this looks in the source directory and then test Java. And in the main package, this is how the tests are divided among individual packages. There's some source main resources. Here's the source main Java, my wrappers inside there for Maven and Gradle and some random files as well. What have we learned? It looks like this is a really nice command line tool that works with your code base entirely, everything inside it, rather than just looking at a few lines at a time or just a single class at a time. That's a really nice feature. Okay, it's costing me a little over $1 to run it, upgrade my code bases, but I think that's probably worth it to me to get in there. And if I was in a company, I'm assuming that would not be a significant charge at all. My one-person company is willing to afford that. So give it a try. Let me know what you think. Hopefully you will find it very useful. If you enjoyed this video, please subscribe so you don't miss any other tales from the jar side. Take care, everybody.